You will be able to manifest anything you desire, but if you are still judging it, then it will show up the opposite. If you're still judging poverty as wrong.
And from this space, you will recognize there is an orchestration happening now. In the culmination of this life, there are the important forces.
A sense of gravity, how it pulls things into each other, how it keeps it grounded and solidified. All of that is where all of these particles come together. It's like a magnet.
In its existence, all at once in all forms, you as consciousness, even in your individuation, have access to every single of those realities.
To be already in the frequency to the feelings and emotions of gratitude, of being grateful for all that already exists in your life.
So the first question is, what is the law of attraction?
Oh, yes. Welcome. I am Saint Germain. We welcome you all. We would be showing our channel that the law of attraction is based on your vibrational frequency. Where are you vibrating in this moment? What is it that you are putting out to the universe? It is when you have raised your vibration to that of a frequency of divine love, you would attract more divine love to you. This is the law of attraction. What and where you're vibrating at is what you will attract to you. Many of you watching this already know this law of attraction. You are already familiar with this concept. You are already familiar with the frequencies. We would recommend tapping into the law of magnetism as well. This would help accelerate for those of you who are wanting to manifest more in your reality. The law of magnetism is opposites attract. Ah, how could I do both at the same time? I am doing and playing out the law of attraction and attracting to me what I desire. And the law of magnetism is doing the polarity of that. We would say to turn both on at the same time by simply putting the intention, I will step into the law of attraction and attract what I desire to me. But yet when I create something bad or what I consider to be bad in my reality, in my perception, I consider it to be something bad or wrong, then I say, I didn't create that. I'm taking responsibility that I created the good in my life. But where are you taking responsibility that you created the bad as well? You must take responsibility that you create all frequencies and everything in your reality. You must take responsibility that you create all in your reality in order to change your reality. You must first master poverty in order to create wealth. You must first master love in order to conquer loneliness. You must first master illness in order to create wellness. Oh, what do you mean by this? How would I master the frequencies? And we would say to stop judging them. You are judging them from an ego perception. You were saying when something bad happens to me, I did not create that. But when something good happens to me, I did create it. And you were judging the fact that when something bad happens or someone in something in your perception that is bad, we wouldn't call it bad in our perception. It just is, it simply is, because we're not judging it. But from an ego perception, you are judging it. And you were saying that something is good, bad, right, or wrong. And we would say it is neither. This is the spot you would be required to resonate in order to attract what you desire to you. This would put you in the fifth dimension reality. This would put you into the now moment. If you had an experience without judgment, if you were standing in the middle of the polarities instead of being in the polarities, you were saying that if something good happens to me, I created that, but if something bad happens, I didn't. And we would say you create it all. When you are attracting to you with the law of attraction, you are asking those who hurt you, you are asking them to come and bring that frequency to you. take responsibility for this. My spirit would go to another spirit and say, I have not yet gotten my power yet. I keep vibrating in lack, and I feel like I am less than, and I am not enough. And yet I haven't mastered transmuting this within myself. Could you come and visit me and criticize me and put me down and tell me that I am not good enough? And when they show up to tell you, you are saying that something is happening to me instead of for me, but your spirit has asked them to bring these frequencies to you so that you can change and master that frequency within you. You do this by not judging it and giving it gratitude. When somebody criticizes you, give it gratitude. If somebody left a mean comment under this video on the YouTube channel, Tara would give gratitude for it, because it is energy and it is not good, bad, right, or wrong. It simply is. It is not negative or positive. It simply is. If you stand in a fifth dimension perception, then a negative comment would propel the algorithms forward just as much as a positive comment. It would propel the algorithms forward. So give gratitude to this. This is the same in your reality when there is people coming into your life and you're feeling attacked and they are being mean to you, and you were saying, this is happening to me. Instead, give gratitude to it and you will master the frequency. Do not judge it. If you are being harmed by another, do not judge it. Stand in a place of non-judgment, and then you will be able to create deliciousness into your reality. You will be able to manifest anything you desire. But if you are still judging it, then it will show up the opposite. If you're still judging poverty as wrong, or bankruptcy as wrong, or as less than, or as embarrassing or humiliating, then you haven't mastered it yet. And it will keep showing up in your reality until you change the frequency within yourself of non-judgment. It is simple, but yet it is difficult when you're in a third dimension reality. We would say to simply observe it, observe the feelings and allow them to arise from your chakra systems of your perception of what bankruptcy feels to you, or what lack of money feels to you. Sit with it, allow it to arise. Most of you, as soon as you begin to feel it, you run from it and you get angry and you say, I did not create this. I do not want poverty in my reality. I do not want bankruptcy, and I refuse to look at it. And yet you are the one that created it so that you could master it. If you master the deepest depths of the frequency in the polarity of the light, then you will know the greatest light. But if you are saying, I will experience a little bit of poverty in my perception, and I am afraid to go any deeper than that, to look at it, then you will only receive that in the polarity in money or in wealth. There are many that would be quite rich on the planet, or quite wealthy on the planet, if they would face these fears. Allow it to come to the surface. Stop hiding. The comfort zone is not where the spirit wants to play. It is within the discomfort that the spirit gets excited. It is within the discomfort that the expansion of the consciousness within you grows. And when it expands out, you can receive more abundance, because you become more abundant within your consciousness. First, master the polarity of what you are, and then you will know who you are. You will know what you are in abundance once you master the polarity of that. One moment, please. Okay, so he's telling me to drink water, so
fair enough. So just so everybody knows that you need to be drinking water, because you're essentially almost overheating as the energy is coming through you. So it's kind of like your radiator fluid, if you really are pulling off the engine.
Yeah, just because they're bringing, like, there's other sendivastors coming through, bringing frequencies through my chakras. So that takes more water. So I have to pause for some cool down. Yeah.
No problem at all. That was an amazing answer to a very simple question.
He kind of goes with things. Yeah,
that was a beautiful answer. And there's a lot packed into that answer too, by the way. It's a dense, I'm going to have to listen to that one again. My next question to Saint Germain in regards to the law of attraction is that there's a lot of misinformation about the law of attraction, about only it being something for physical wealth or things of that manner. and not anything really else. In the, you know, in the zeitgeist, everyone just thinks you just wish for something and it just shows up. Can he clarify what the law of attraction truly is meant to be for us?
It is to play with frequencies. Your spiritual body is put on a human costume and begin to play on planet Earth. You already know the frequency of everything. This isn't your first rodeo. This isn't your first time on planet Earth. You know the frequencies. You know what it is like to be everything and nothing all at once. When you are on planet Earth, you've come to experience the frequencies, because when you are love, when you are compassion, when you are consciousness, then how do you know what you are if you have nothing to compare it to? You are consciousness. You are in a universe that is created in frequency. You see that everything is solid around you, but we do not see it that way. It is an illusion of being solid. It is vibration, and everything is vibrating, and you put on your human costume and you come to planet Earth to experience the frequencies of the polarity of that which you are. You already know the end result. There is not a race to the finish line, because the spirit knows what it is like to be fully conscious.
We draw down and around you now the soul spark of your origin, your point of recognition, what you are. And this does spark within you a longing to understand your own beginnings. And from this space, you will recognize there is an orchestration happening now. In the culmination of this life, there are the important forces which you acknowledge, and there are those unseen who stay, who hover, who are near, who are waiting for the transition of this time. And as they come forward, you will feel within the body, in the bones, in the very fragments of your being and beginnings, that you have come to an understanding that all that was no longer is. And you will feel within yourself there is an important fragrance within the very essence of yourself that must be shared. And no longer will you culminate the hours with the repetition of others' minds, but you will take for yourself the stand of speaking and will come into the world in other ways, and will find yourself being spoken to of one mind with the essence of who you are. And this will come through. And you will find this in times uncertain to be strong and to carry the rhythm of the forces that support you and to elevate the minds of those to whom you enter with the solemn song of your own beginning. Do you understand us?
I do.
Do you have questions for us?
I do. What global events do you see coming for humanity in the coming years?
There is the shift, the change of which you are aware, the changing of the times on offer. There is instrumental into the humanity's evolution. There is an uncertainty that you bear. Currently, you are enmeshed in the beginnings of this next offering. And you feel it as a tumultuous now. Your existence feels as though you plow on into the effort to recreate what was, and yet the new beginnings erupt all around you. And there is the struggle and the turmoil, the resistance and the purge. And this evolution continues. It is the demise of the carrying on of the masculine light, the vibration of that which has held humanity to structure and allowing, to structure and forbearing. There is within this duality the resistance of one another, the resistance within the mind, the resistance within the happening of the human body. There is the sense that there is one above and one below. And we would bring humanity into harmony, into an understanding of itself as something balanced, of having within the sense of the divine as two equal parts. And for this to occur, there must be the elevation of the feminine mind, which has been repressed, which has been subjugated, which has been left behind. And there is within this duality, within each and every soul, each and every person, in every facet of this life, this duality exists. And there is the cacophony of voices which permeate the world, which speak to it and hold it now and keep it as it stands. And there must be a gentle yet vibration to begin this interference, to create this change. And this will arrive soon now, soon now. There will be an instance energetic that comes before your eyes, a presence. You will feel it, yes, and a shifting happens internal, inside. And this is yet the beginnings of a multifaceted approach to the shifting, that arrives. There are yet other instantiations of difficulty which will come. And we herald these as an aspect of the change that will arrive. And there are those who will inhabit these times, who will feel their arrivals and will know themselves transported, and the demise and cease of functions which have bound and held humanity into forms of repression, these will subside. And in the end, you will find yourselves in a place and spirit evolved from the place and understanding of self as one dimension of expression, as one aspected union, and instead see the myriad of choices you become. To be the one among many souls, the oneness comes. Do you understand us?
I do. Are there any specific signs or symptoms of a shift in consciousness that we as individuals should be aware of?
Yes, you are held now in a frequency that is changing as we speak. You are following your pathways, dear, each and every one held differently among yourselves. There is no one path. There is no one moment now, no one time that must come for all. There is, yes, the instantiations of energies which come, which flourish, which aid, which help, and you are held, each are held in their own ascension to understand, dears. You have time. Time to understand what happens within. There are aspects of each soul which must be revealed, for the knowledge gathering time is now, the time to glean your lives from all that is learning, from all you have experienced. The time is now for understanding soul and self. This is the opportunity before you now, to take these moments of tranquility, to take these times of awareness where confrontations surround you and you are shown yourselves in deep relief and pattern, and you may glean from this the deep furrows of your own worry and come to understanding of what has formed you. And these, as you come into fold, will disappear. For the time, though long it seems, it withers. The time for self-learning draws to a close, and then begins a next phase of opening. And you will find in your hearts a gentle gliding without fear, a sense of self in harmonic balance. And this is not to say that all will perform their life without conflict or constraint. No, it merely says that a harmonic balance is achieved, that you may orchestrate a life of presence and self-awareness, and from within that context, experience yourself within this plane of existence. And in the times forming around you now, this opportunity remains to confront the self for self-learning. This is the time. It is now. It is now. Do you understand us?
I do. Thank you. How can we help others who are struggling with the spiritual awakening process?
There are many in the tide of resistance who conform themselves to what was, who wish to know no more of their own inner vision, who stay perturbed by the external. And they are in difficult times ahead. And we will feel their sorrow and their pain. And we wish for them the awakening. We wish for them the feeling of support that we offer. We wish for them to be transported as you are toward the awareness. And you ask, you say, what is it? What is it that creates the separation between us and they? We hear nothing. And we say, merely the awareness that you are, the separation from all that surrounds you as external, and the comprehension that what does provide this vision is your own inner landscape. It is this separation that occurs. And those who cannot be freed from the outer illusion cannot find the relief that they seek. They find themselves distraught. And for them, we ring the bell of compassion in each and every heart. We wish for you to separate no longer from they who are in resistance.
You have a new manifestation, a new place, new doorway, a new property where you walk in. And you no longer have the other one.
Well, let me ask you this. We are all things in this existence are made up of atoms, electrons, neutrons, and so on. What quantum physics has, and even scientists have been able to determine now, is that we are all energy. You go down as far as you can with a microscope. There is space between. There is no solid anything. No. There's nothing that's solid. That materialism has kind of been thrown upside down because of that, because it's just been proven that that's not the case. My question to you is, what organizes the atoms into Christy, into Alex, into the table behind you, into the microphone? What is the organizing factor that brings those together for a time and then deconstructs it as time goes by?
Well, that is the science in the quantum physics. That is the sense of physics. That's where we say it is all the same. It's where one in the energetic spirit realm, if you will, then gets translated into the physical, gravitational, physical polarity world. This is where it lowers its vibration and then coalesces. It comes together. It's like a sense of gravity, how it pulls things into each other, how it keeps it grounded and solidified. All of that is where all of these particles come together. It's like a magnet magnetizing something to it. It's where the denser on this physical earth plane collect all of those different particles, all of those different energetic vibrations to come together to create the matter. But you cannot have matter without the energy. It doesn't exist.
Right. That's how planets and solar systems are created, where the over time, the gravitational pull is being brought in and brought in, brought until the point where it creates the planet, it creates a solar system because of the gravitational pull of a star or sun or something along those lines, correct?
Exactly. It is by that, and understanding that it is with your question, how is spirituality and quantum physics, many think of them as so different. But when you think about it, you are a physical man. Christy is a physical woman. But what's animating you?
Right.
When you look at something or someone that is no longer alive, there's no pulse. There's no processing of the mind.
Energy's
that
gone.
Person cannot talk anymore. All right. of that is the energy. It's life force. So you can't have the physical without the non-physical, without it then being considered, oh, this person is no longer alive. They are dead. What is the life? It's the energy. And you need both to have that animation.
Is that kind of, then what is consciousness in this conversation? How does consciousness and quantum physics connect?
It's one. See, you understand that consciousness, there's higher consciousness, which is energy.
Mm-hmm.
Energy, it's a spectrum. The purest energy is pure positive. It is each of you individuals that say, I want to feel peace. I want to feel abundance. I want to feel freedom. I want to feel joy. And as you are the partnering aspect, the physical to the non-physical, as you are claiming, declaring, intending, wishing, there's many words for it, as you are saying, I want to feel, I want to receive the energy of compassion, that pure positive energy coalesces into that exact vibration. Think of it like a piano keyboard. You have a whole spectrum mm-hmm. of notes.
Right.
Who chooses the notes?
The consciousness.
It's not energy.
Right. It's the consciousness of the person.
Yes, you, the player, say, I want to hit this note or that note or many notes together, then to create something in the physical that becomes a song. But consciousness, pure consciousness, each and every one of you are filled with divine consciousness. And your divine consciousness is always pulsating to the space of pure support. If we could bring it into a place for humans to understand and interpret, you're designed for wholeness and well-being. The divine part of you never focuses on sickness or separation. It has no consciousness of that. And that purity of consciousness, whether it's focused on the prosperity or the abundance or the success, it never goes into not enoughness or lack. Mm-hmm. It stays consistent in that higher vibration. Now it's the human that when you hook up with that higher consciousness, you then feel the expansiveness of that success, of that abundance, of that well-being. It's the free-willed individual that has their own consciousness. Let's talk about this for a minute, because this is mm-hmm. big.
Mm-hmm.
If divine consciousness is pure positive energy and it's always coming through you, it's what you're breathing, it's what is beating your heart, it's what all of you have accessible to you, it's in front of you, it's to the side, it's in you, it's all around. There's no place that divine consciousness is not. But you as the human being, with the words that you say, with the thoughts that you think, with the perspective, with the images that you hold in your own individual minds, with the feelings you either feel or process, and the very actions, the very behaviors, the habits, this is how a individual's consciousness gets formed. And depending on those actions of consciousness, are you bringing in the divine consciousness of divine thoughts? Are you speaking divine words that are expansive and match that pure positive energy? Or are you negating it, speaking away from it?
So then let me ask you this. I understand the concept of what you're talking about regarding the consciousness of the person. But what about the consciousness of the flower or the ant or the animal or the tree? Where's that consciousness and where's that programming, if you will? I understand how we are programmed, meaning the code for us, if you will, to use the analogy of computer code. What is the computer code, if you will, for the rose, which is conscious as it when it's alive? It follows the sun, the blade of grass follows the sun, gets the nutrients. There's a limited amount of consciousness there. Even ants, limited amount. Animals, limited, all at different levels. Where does that come from?
That comes from the energy. It comes from the pure positivity. It comes from, if a rose, for example, has grown through the stem and budded, it has that energetic consciousness. It's the same pure consciousness that grows that blade of grass, that has that energy through the tree. But yes, different from the tree to the blade of grass, to the rosebud, and to you, there is human consciousness. The blade of grass, think about it this way. The blade of grass does not say to another blade of grass, I'm better than you are. It doesn't have that consciousness.
Right.
The rose does not say to the other one, my color is better than your color. It doesn't have that awareness. It doesn't have that ability to compare and contrast like humans do. It just blooms. It doesn't have, difference. It doesn't have any resistance to following the light.
Situation with your understanding of time currently is that there was a before your existence, or there is a before or an after this now moment. However, it is also simultaneous, and therefore every soul contract, every plan that you had for yourself before your life is the plan that is having or are having or is having in this current now.
Are we living in a simulation?
In a manner of speaking, yes, because consciousness itself is not what you believe it to be, in that there is no matter truly. There is, of course, on the human level and on many of the other levels of consciousness, in that consciousness slows down to become what is can be perceived as matter. And that would be the simulation that you would be thinking that you are living in, but thinking itself is also inside the simulation. And it is not an external simulation created by some other beingness, as it is all consciousness. So you can imagine it is like a video game, in that you yourself as consciousness are creating yourself and all of the players. And you have chosen in this now to be the version of the playerness that you most identify with as now. But that is not to say that simultaneously you are not also all of the other players and all of the objects and all of the thought forms.
Can you explain reincarnation?
Reincarnation is a concept based upon time being linear as well. And as it is simultaneous, one can explain reincarnation as the knowingness. For example, if you have a recollection of a past life, yes, then this is the recollection, the ability to tap into another version of you in another simultaneous now with your consciousness. So the recollection of past lives is not that they have actually happened in the past. They have happened or are happening or will happen in the simultaneous now in any of this particular timelines, versions of reality in this now, or in parallel versions of reality. This also accounts for the fact that sometimes people have recollections of past lives and you go to check your history books and the being that they recall themselves to be was not quite exactly as they recall them. For example, someone remembers being Joe, and Joe in the memory was a warrior, and Joe in the record books that you have was a farmer. And someone says, well, then reincarnation cannot possibly exist. However, the being that is remembering being Joe is remembering a parallel version of Joe, which they are simultaneously in this now. In fact, you are a reincarnation of all of the beings that you know. You are all one.
Can you explain the concept of parallel universes, or the multiverse, if you will?
In a concise mode, we cannot. But this is because it is a concept that is very abstract still to your understanding. But the nutshell version would be that everything exists all at once in all forms. And in its existence, all at once in all forms, you as consciousness, even in your individuation, have access to every single of those realities. You are at times pointed to this with meditations or what is called quantum jumping or mind aspects, techniques that you are practicing on this planet. And often you tune into a parallel version of yourself. This is a limited way to use the concept of multiverse, in that you do not need to tap into a parallel version of yourself. You may tap into any version of any self, as you are all one. So if you have an admiration for the skills and genius of, say, Leonardo da Vinci, you may at any time tap into his consciousness, whether in this past, present reality simultaneousness, or in any other version of that individuation's parallel incarnations, realities, planets. And if you want to take it even further, if you have a wide enough imagination, you may tap into the consciousness of anything at all.
So you're telling me that at this moment right now, there is an endless amount of parallel versions of myself doing things at a, I could be a someone evil. I could be an astronaut. I could be a physicist. I could be a basketball player. I could be, you know, a channeler, in other lives as we're speaking right now, multiple, just copies of myself, if you will.
Yes. And we are saying you could be a rock and an ant and a planet and a speck of dust and a grain of sand and a molecule of water and a virus and a apple.
Interesting. So if everything is happening at the same time, then do we, as a soul, as a conscious, a consciousness or soul, know the outcome of where this is all going to end? Meaning that as far as incarnations are concerned,
yes, but there is no end. Again, we bring it back to the apple. There is no end because you may be in a previous future simultaneous incarnation, an apple or a fiber of a shirt. So there is no end because there is no time. Time cannot end if it does not exist. And we do know that in your particular incarnation, in your simulation, if you will, that you have created for yourself in this fraction of experiencing that you have chosen, that you have instilled the program or the concept of time so that you can have the experiences that you are having that are dependent upon time existing as a concept, but it is not necessary outside of your human experience.
When it comes down to manifestation, it really is a matter of having, being in the frequency of what you want to manifest, because your external reality is a frequency match to your internal state. So manifestation is not a matter of, let's say, mantras and thinking about the things that you want, but it is a matter of becoming that which you desire to manifest. So we are not saying become a car, for example, although become the version of you that has the new car and maintain the frequencies that allow you to be that being. So many of you ask about money, wealth. So what is it? How is it that a wealthy person, when it comes to money, be? How do they be? How do they feel? So we advise to be already in the frequency to the feelings and emotions of gratitude, of being grateful for all that already exists in your life, for already feeling wealthy for all that is already in your life, and then taking, this is a very important step that many people miss, which is taking the aligned action, following your passion and taking that aligned action without fear of making a mistake or taking wrong paths or making wrong choices. And as long as you are cultivating those frequencies and taking the aligned action, there is no other choice but for you to manifest things. And if it doesn't go the way that you planned, at least you will get life experiences and feedback.
How can we have free will if there is a soul blueprint or a destiny that we agreed to come down to this earth to do?
The most important thing to remember when it comes to free will is that when you connect to your heart and you tap into what truly your heart desires, not your mind, not your ego, tapping into your heart, then you discover what is it that you want to pursue, that you want to follow. Then that gives you the free will to make the choice to follow what's in alignment with your heart. Many people will believe that they are not following their free will because there was something to do with their blueprint. But a lot of the times, that belief is attached to an ego desire. So connecting to the heart and making sure that is something that really, truly feels in full alignment with your heart's desire, not because somebody told you, society told you that you have to do, or your family told you that you have to do, and you want to impress others, then that is an ego-based desire. So when you are connecting to your heart's desire, then you will feel like you have free will to choose.
How do we connect to our higher selves?
Connecting to higher self, it is also another process that we recommend connecting to your heart. Connecting to your heart and trusting in yourself, in what is coming through into your field. A lot of the times, to connect deeper to your higher self or even connect to your higher self in the first place, you need to remove the beliefs and programs that have you stop, that have you think that you are making it up, or others will think I'm crazy. It's just my imagination. It is a matter of removing the beliefs that have you thinking that in the first place, and then your channel is clear and you are able to connect to hear your higher self on a deeper level, because your higher self is always connected to you and is always giving you messages. It's a matter of removing the distortions that and disruptions that are on the way.
From your perspective, what is the ultimate purpose or goal of spiritual evolution?
There are a couple of perspectives that we would like to share. The purpose of spiritual evolution is to support humans to evolve beyond what they believe and perceive life to be, because you don't know what you don't know. And through spiritual evolution, you start to learn more about the things that you don't know. And the second part of our answer is that it is another way that certain souls that come to planet Earth as humans will choose to experience their human experience. I want to go to Earth and have an experience as a spiritual being that is on a path of spiritual evolution. You could say it is a life experience that many choose to go through.
How do you navigate the balance between individuality and unity consciousness?
It all comes down to integrity, to who you are being when no one is watching. Are you being in integrity to yourself? And then are you being in integrity to the collective, so that you can support yourself first and foremost at the highest, and then the collective?
How do you maintain a state of inner peace amongst all the challenges of life?
To maintain inner peace, it is so important that you are present. Yes, there is time on your planet Although time is an illusion, the past and the present, the past and the future is an illusion. And the more that you connect to the truth of the present, of being present, there is no other choice for you to feel inner peace. And of course, you are going to be sitting with yourself in the present, and many things and emotions and feelings and thoughts may arise. And it's a matter of accepting as well all that is. And in that process, you may even laugh at all that arises and all the worries that you may put on all the things that may be happening in your life. And then you realize how your all that is, it is being a frequency match to who you are being. So it is so important that you are present, that you cultivate that inner peace so that you can create more of that in your external reality.
Why do we suffer in life?
You suffer in life because there is a choice. It is a choice to come to a planet of duality, a planet of contrast. And the level of suffering is also a choice. You may choose to suffer because of certain situations, or you may choose to just surrender and trust that there is a lesson or whatever it is that there is for you there. So remembering that suffering, a lot of the times, not all the time, a lot of the times is a choice.
How do you approach the concept of ego and its role in the spiritual evolution?
Well, the ego is very much part of humans, and many humans will live only an ego-based life in their current lifetime. And ego is there as also part of the contrast to support humans to evolve and ascend. Because the more you observe your human self, your ego self, you are then able to see the contrast experience of it, which is your spiritual self, which is beyond the veil of illusion. So the ego, you could say, it is an experience of who you are not, so that you have the duality, contrasting experience to discover who you truly are.
How do you quiet the negative voices in our head?
There are many ways. A lot of the negative voices in humans' head is because of a dysregulated nervous system. So it can be something quite physiological. And it can also be related to trauma, childhood trauma, ancestral trauma, and also beliefs from society, religious beliefs. So it is a matter of going to the unconscious root of why those negative thoughts are there in the first place. A lot of the times, we could even say most of the times, those thoughts are there because of an unconscious pattern that is running in the background. So as long as that unconscious pattern is dealt with, then the thought, new thoughts can start to come in.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.